good morning, good afternoon, good evening, whatever time of day it is, and wherever you might find yourself. We want to welcome each one of you to church this morning. What a phenomenal time to actually be in the presence of the Lord. I hope you guys had an awesome, awesome week. You know, we've been speaking about, and Pastor John's been speaking about the power of a renewed mind. And I hope that in this week that you practice that you practice learning what the Word of God says about your life and putting it into practice by meditating on that Word and also declaring that Word over your life. I want to encourage you that while you are watching now, that you do a couple things for me. Why don't you like, subscribe, and share this post? Let people know about what's happening at the Durban Christian Center. If you say that this is home and we family, then how's about letting people know that there is a house and a family that is open and available for them to be a part of, and this is the Jesus Dome. We are a house of prayer for all nations and a place where miracles actually do happen. And I want to tell you that there's nothing that is impossible with God. So I'm just so glad to be in your house, and wherever you are, I'm so glad to be with you this morning. And I want to just encourage you and let you know that God loves you. There's a great plan for your life, and that nothing that you put your trust in the Lord for is impossible. There's nothing too big for the Lord. And I think that's such an awesome thing to know, that there's such an awesome peace that comes upon us when we know that God has got our back. There's nothing that's too difficult for Him. There's nothing that takes God by surprise. So I want to encourage you now, while we're online, while we're chatting together, me with you in your homes, I want to encourage you, let us know where you're watching from. Drop a comment in the comment section and let us know where you're watching from. You know, it's such a privilege, it's such an exciting moment when we get to see who's watching and where they're watching from. It's so exciting for everybody that's here on the broadcast. We get so excited when we find out where you're watching from. So let us know where you're watching from. Drop a comment in the comment section. We'd love to celebrate with you, praise the Lord with you, acknowledge you in a time when we're going to just go through everybody that's watching and just acknowledge some folks. Let us know where you're watching from, and also if you have any prayer requests. As I said, we are a house of prayer for all nations, and we do believe in miracles. And I want to encourage you to drop a comment in the comment section and let us know if there's any prayer requests, no matter what it is. If you think it's too difficult for you, then this is the right place for you to be. Because there's nothing too difficult with our God. And the Word of God says that if two or more agree touching on anything, it shall be done by our Father who's in heaven. So I want to tell you that while you drop in those comments and letting us know what your prayer requests are, our intercessors and myself as well, we are waiting to receive those prayer requests, and we're going to pray about them. We're going to trust God with you and agree with God with you that nothing that you're trusting God for will be unanswered. Everything that you're trusting God for, He's going to answer it. He's going to meet you at the point of your need. You are going to experience breakthrough. You are going to experience healing. You are going to experience His loving kindness and His warm embrace. There is nothing that God will withhold from us when we put our trust in Him. Activate your faith by dropping a comment in the comment section and letting us know what your prayer request is, declaring that as we stand together in agreement for your prayer request, declaring that every single prayer request will be answered, every single need will be met. And also let us know in the comment section if this church and ministry has impacted your life in any way. You know, it's so encouraging when we actually watch and read all your testimonies of what the Lord has done through this ministry. And it also encourages us to know that what we're doing is impacting not only your life, but the lives of those around you, the vicinity and the areas in which you are living in. So we want to touch and impact your lives, not only in Durban, not only in South Africa, but all over the world. We want to touch and change, transform lives, and lead people to Jesus. You know, the greatest gift that we have is to lead somebody to Jesus. And so many times we get into this rut of just going through life and being tossed by whatever comes our way. And what Pastor John's been teaching us and preaching to us is on the power of a renewed mind. And you know what? I've been practicing this in my life, and I've been saying, Lord, I'm taking your word, I'm meditating on your word. I'm going to declare this word over my circumstances. And I want to encourage you, drop a comment in the comment section right now and declare that nothing is too hard for the Lord. Declare some scriptures over your life. Declare some scriptures over your situation. Let the devil know, let the world know that you're standing for righteousness. I think it's so awesome to stand for righteousness. Don't you? If you believe that standing for righteousness is the greatest privilege on earth, drop a comment in the comment section. Let us know whether you're excited about serving God, just the way we are here at the Jesus Dome. We love the Lord. We love lifting up His holy name. We love doing things to let people know who our God is and what He is capable of doing in lives. And that is why we do so many things out in the communities and so many things for our church body. So we do so many events, and we have Bible school, and we have Awaken, and we have Operation Up. And these are the things that I want to touch on today, because I think that these are such great initiatives for you and I to be a part of, to get ourselves plugged into and participate in. Like Bible school. DCCBI, our Bible school right here at the Jesus Dome, offers open for our second term of studying. So I want to encourage you that if you are interested in studying the Word of God, let me tell you something. Studying the Word of God is the greatest investment in yourself that you will ever, ever, ever make. So I want to encourage you, get yourself involved in Bible school. Get yourself in studying the Word of God. It equips you, it empowers you, it gets you to know who you are in Christ. And what a great reward it is when you know who you are in Christ, when you find the identity that you have in God, when you walk in that identity. There's so much power that you receive. There's so much confidence that you have. People in the world, society will say you're proud, but I'm telling you, that's the confidence of God walking and a living epistle of Jesus Christ. I mean, I don't believe that Jesus was one that whimpered out and was scared to declare what the Word of God says, what the Lord said, what God said about Him. He spoke. He said, I am the Son of God. And He performed miracles. And Jesus says this before He died. He says, we would be able to do even greater than what He did when He leaves this earth. So He had to go so that we be able to do even greater things. So I want to encourage you that while you're studying the Word of God, be excited about it. Be excited about studying the Word of God with us through our DCCBI Institute. And listen, I know that so many of us are watching from outside of Durban, and you're saying, Cody, how am I going to be able to study the Word? I can't get into lectures. Well, it's a good thing that we have all our lectures online, so you can register with us and do all your assessments, all your studies. Study material is online, so you'll be able to study with us and be a part of the great work that has been done through our DCCBI. Also, we have our Awaken that takes place every single Saturday morning at 10 a.m. What is Awaken, you might ask? Well, Awaken is our evangelism. So we go out into the communities and let people know about Jesus. And I want to tell you that there's a lot of people that say, oh, this is not for me. I can't go out and speak to people about Jesus. But I want to tell you something. It is the greatest reward when you see the revelation of Jesus Christ being made manifest in somebody's life, when people are introduced to Jesus, the excitement, the relief, the freedom that they receive when you tell somebody about Jesus, it is absolutely addictive. I think that's the only way I could actually explain it. It is so, it's the biggest dopamine boost that you will ever have. So I want to encourage you to be a part of that every single Saturday. It's going to be phenomenal. I can't wait to get into the presence of the Lord and praise God together. So let's join the rest of our family as we worship the Lord and praise His holy name.
Honor you. If you believe that this morning, come on family, give the Lord a shout of praise. Give Him a shout of praise. Come on, give Him a shout of praise. Come on, lift up the volume this morning. He's worthy of all the glory. He's worthy of all the honor. He's worthy of all the worship. Come on, come on, don't stop. A little longer, a little longer. Come on, He is the King of all kings. He is the King of glory. He is mighty. He is holy. He is awesome. Shout if you believe.
Together, just like the elders, just like the angels. Hallelujah. Oh, oh. Hey, 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 hey. Hallelujah. The angels bow down at the thought of you. The darkness gives way to the light. Forever we worship you.
Somebody saw the name of Jesus.
Can walk in victory. Isn't that amazing? Thank God for everything that Jesus has done. Well, a very good morning to each and every one of you. It's so good for us to be together. It's so wonderful that we can come and worship the Lord, and thank you for coming and joining us today. It's so excited. We are so excited to see our family. I wonder how many of you are here for the very first time, you visiting here at the Jesus Dome for the very first time. Can you wave your hand at us this morning? Right, there's some hands in the back. Family, can we give them a very big welcome? We're going to hand back to the presenters. And this is our time to really love on one another, greet one another, and make one another feel special. Let's go.
Man, I absolutely love what that song said. It said, I won't stop until the whole world knows your name. I won't stop serving the Lord. And I want to just take this time once again to welcome you. If you've just joined us, I want to take this time to welcome you to church this morning. This is a place where miracles happen and a house of prayer for all nations. And we are so glad that you have joined us in worshiping, praising, and lifting up the name of Jesus together with us. I want to just take this time to acknowledge some folks that are watching us all over the world and watching us in KZN. And I want to just take some time. There's YouTube and Facebook that folks are watching us on. And I want to encourage you that while you're watching, that you like, share, and comment. Don't forget to comment. Commenting is so good because we get to interact with you live while you're watching the service. So when we saying amen, you at home are watching and saying amen with us. We're participating in this world together, man. So I want to take this time to acknowledge some folks, but don't forget, like, share, and comment if you have any prayer requests. Now's the time. Drop a comment in the comment section. It's church o'clock, and this is the time where we get to get together, gather together, lift His name up, and pray together, believing God that nothing that we put our trust in the Lord for is impossible. So I want to take some time now to acknowledge some folks that are watching on YouTube. We've got Geeta that's watching us, Cindy Moodley that's watching us, Peter Blaine, who's watching all the way from Saudi Arabia. There's also Sanula that's watching us, Nancy Moodley that's watching us, Rita that's watching us. There's Denise Thomas, Ashika Naidu who's watching. There's also Wayne Moodley who's watching us all the way from PMB. I just want to take this time to say thank you so much to each one of you that are watching on Facebook, on YouTube. There's Cliffy Prince that's watching, Mika Chetty that's watching, Reese that's watching, Beverly Governor that's watching, Nondo Miso that's watching. So many of you that are watching, I'm so glad that each one of you are here praising the Lord with us, lifting up His name. And I just want to do that. Let's get back into the service and praise His name together with the Lord and just lift Him up, for He's great and He's greatly to be praised. Let's get back in and worship the Lord.
Trial, no matter the battle, I already know. highest praise.
You alone deserve it all, and we lift your name. Come on, church. We lift your name. Jesus, you deserve it all. You alone deserve. One more time. We lift. Hey, everybody, we lift.
We lift
your name. We lift your name. Jesus, you deserve it all. You alone deserve. One more time, we lift.
Oh,
the name that is above every other name. Jesus, you deserve it all. And you alone. Jesus, you deserve it all.
Jesus, you deserve it all.
And you alone. Jesus. Come on. Seated this morning, and we want to extend a warm welcome to our various campuses with Pastor Mervin all the way in Phoenix. Can we put our hands together, family, and give them a good love and appreciation? We so love and appreciate each and every one of you. And then our other campus.
Yes, our other campus in Hillcrest. Welcome, Hillcrest. Come on, let's give Hillcrest
welcome
a great
to all
big
of you wonderful
God
people
bless you
this morning. And we are coming to have communion together. I'm going to ask those who are serving communion if you could go ahead and do that this morning. We're going to get ourselves ready. And we're one church.
With many rooms.
And with many rooms in various locations. And I don't know of any greater way to express and represent unity than when it comes to sharing communion together with one another, and of course doing that throughout the campuses. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, and we're going to read from verse 12, it says, for as the body is one, as the body is what?
One.
The body is what?
One.
The body is one, but it has many members, and thank God for the variety, right?
Amen.
Thank God for all the varieties that we have. There's only one Pastor Danny. Amen. There's only one Sister Cookie. There's only one Pastor Mervin, by the way. And
only one Pastor Mark.
My goodness. And last night we had some fun as he was dancing for us. We had a Thanksgiving. And but only one of you. Look at somebody right now and tell them there's only one of you. And that's the variety, the many varied members in the body of Christ. But how many bodies do we have? One body. Many members, but only one body, right? But all the members of that one body, being many, are one body, so also is Christ. Verse 13 says, the next verse coming up, for by one Spirit, we were all of us, no matter our backgrounds, no matter our cultures, we were all baptized into one body, whether Jew, whether Zulu, whether Khoisan,
whether sepedi, giela dumedisa, gavi, I can't remember what I said, but anyways, I spoke a bit of sepedi when I was in Polokwane, Limpopo. But we're whether Jews or Greeks, whether slaves or free, and have all been made to drink into one spirit, verse 14 says, for in fact, it's a fact, the body is not one member but many. Amen. And then if we go down to verse 18, it says there, but now, when? Tomorrow? When Jesus comes back? But now God has set the members, each one of them, in the body just as he pleased. And I'm so grateful to God for each and every one of you that are here in the Jesus Dome, those of you that are there in Phoenix, those of you that are in Hillcrest, and the other campuses that we are trusting God to establish and other churches to plant. I think it's phenomenal.
Yes,
it's great. Yes. And something that you were saying, sweetheart, when it comes to communion.
When we come to communion, isn't it wonderful that that word, it's almost like it's saying a common union. We all have a common union
right.
with Jesus' birth, how Jesus lived on earth. He died, was crucified, but he rose again. And because of that, we can all be one body and one family. And, you know, this is also called the table of the Lord.
Mm.
And as a family, when we all come together, if we were having a big party here tonight, we'd be all sitting at a table. So today we're at the table of the Lord, remembering everything that he accomplished for us on the cross of Calvary. And isn't that wonderful that we can do that as a family, not only here in the Jesus Dome, with you guys in Hillcrest and in Phoenix. As a family, we can celebrate Jesus today. And you know, at that time, it was Passover. They were sitting at a table having Passover. And when I was thinking about it this morning, I just want to tell you, as a congregation here in Durban, in Durban Christian Center, in Hillcrest, and in Phoenix, it doesn't matter what you're facing. Because of Passover, it shall pass over in Jesus' name.
Yeah.
I don't know what you're facing because of the blood of Jesus.
That's right.
And because of what he accomplished on the cross,
praise God,
it shall pass over in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. And we also want to remind each other, as we're one house, many locations, that of course our theme for this year is so much more in 2024. And as we come to partake of this meal, let's remember that. Let's keep reminding ourselves, Ephesians 3:20. That's our scripture for this year, because we are trusting and believing that every single one of you are going to experience so much more in 2024. How many of you know there's always more in God? There's always so much more. When you are in Christ, he has so much more to offer, and this meal is a reminder. So let's go ahead this morning in the various campuses, get our meals ready, and let's take a hold of the bread. On the night that he was betrayed, Jesus took the bread, broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, take and eat. This is my body that was broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Let's go ahead, family, and partake together. And then in like manner, he took the cup, and again he blessed it and gave thanks, gave it to his disciples and said, take and drink. This is the cup of my blood that was shed for the remission of your sins. Do this in remembrance of me. Let's go ahead together, family, and partake. Praise the Lord. If you can hand those cups back. And then I want to thank Pastor Mervyn and all the wonderful people there in Phoenix. And I want to thank Pastor Mark and Megan all of you doing a great job and all of the wonderful people there. We're going to hand back right now, back to the pastors. Can we put our hands together as we wave goodbye to all of them? Wonderful. Praise the Lord. Well, Pastor Wayne has a word for you this morning. Can you put your hands together and give him a big God bless you as he comes this morning? Thank you, Wayne.
Pastor John, and a very good morning to each and every one of you and those that are watching online. This is the time where we can continue our worship in these generous moments. And I'd like to just quickly talk to you in order to help us give from a biblical perspective about the new ministry of the priest and king. 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 9, the Bible says, and I wonder if you could join with me and let's read it together. Here we go. It's up on the screen. 1, 2, 3. But you are God's chosen treasure, priests who are kings, a spiritual nation set apart as God's devoted ones. We are priests who are kings. And of course, that includes all of us. This is not a gender thing. This is a function thing and an authority thing. I wonder if you could join with me as we say this declaration together in light of what we have just spoken. Family, I wonder if you would take a deep breath and let's say this all together. Here we go. 1, 2, 3. I am a significant and valuable part of God's chosen generation. I am a royal kingly priest. I am God's possession, God's purchased and special person. I am chosen, royal, consecrated in Jesus' name. Do you believe that this morning? What really this means is that each and every one of us have been favored in our position in God's eyes. But with that favor comes a responsibility. If you have a look at the priest in the Old Testament, they had a clearly marked out, defined ministry. They were to stand guard in the house of God. They were to instruct people so that they could walk in the blessing of God. But here is a third aspect that kind of touches on what we're about to do as unto the Lord. They were to make sacrifices for God's people. And I do believe that as priests, you and I are still today engaged in sacrifice. You say, well, where do you find that in the Bible? 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 5, the Bible says, for now you serve as holy priests. You, Durban Christian Center, we all serve as holy priests. And notice what the Bible says, offering up spiritual sacrifices that he, God, readily accepts through Jesus Christ. And if we are priests and if we are kings, the question is, what sacrifices do we make? There is a new regime of sacrifices. Thank goodness we don't take lambs and bulls and get the red heifer and go and sacrifice that as unto the Lord. That's all closed. But now there is a sacrifice of a new kind that we offer to the Lord. Hebrews 13:15 gives us insight as to one of those sacrifices. So we no longer offer up a steady stream of blood sacrifices. That's all closed. That regime is closed. But through Jesus, we will offer up to God a steady stream of praise sacrifices. These are the lambs we offer from our lips that celebrate his name. Isn't that wonderful? What is one of the ways that we give sacrifices as unto the Lord? It's by praise and by thanksgiving. But the second type of sacrifice speaks to our finances. In verse 16 of that same chapter, the Bible says, do not forget or neglect to do kindness and good, to be generous and distribute and contribute to the needy of the church as embodiment and proof of fellowship. Now, notice what the Bible says, for such sacrifices are pleasing to God. In other words, the Bible sees, God sees our giving as a priestly, kingly function. And what we are doing is we are giving sacrifices as unto the Lord. And we see that with Paul when he writes to the church at Philippi in response to the offering that they gave him. The book of Philippi, or the Philippians rather, was written in response of the generosity of Philippi. And he says, I have received full payment and more. Here's the generosity of the priests. I am well supplied, the generosity of the priest, having received from Epaphroditus the gifts you sent. And notice how Paul describes this offering. This is an offering to a ministry, the legitimate ministry of Paul. He says, this offering is a fragrant offering, a sacrifice acceptable and pleasing to God. Another translation says, your generosity is like a lovely fragrance, a sacrifice that pleases the very heart of God. Another translation says, you see, I've got to be like Pastor John and bring out these translations, like a sweet-smelling sacrifice roasting on the altar. That's sacrifice talk. That's priestly function talk, filling the air with fragrance, pleasing God no end. And so we understand that as priests, we sacrifice, and we don't sacrifice animals. We give a praise thanksgiving as unto the Lord, and we give unto the Lord. Family, if God speaks of our sacrifice in such a way, it means that when we give to the Lord, it is agreeable to Him, it is pleasing to Him, and it is acceptable to Him. This is what God approves and welcomes. Your and my generosity to the work of God is what God would approve and welcome as a function of the priest. What that tells us, because the Bible says that this is something that's a sweet-smelling savor as unto the Lord, and sweetness is what you taste. It's not really what you smell, it's what you taste. And it tells us that giving to the house of the Lord is the highest value in the sight of God. I'm so blessed by your thunderous amens this morning. This is Bible. Let me say it again, that giving is the highest value in the sight of God. And when we give as priests and kings. And you know, family, many times when you ask somebody, what's your goal, what's your aim? Oh, I want to be like Jesus. Well, here's a practical thing that Jesus did in relation to the priestly, kingly function, office and anointing. Look at Ephesians chapter 5 verse 1. Therefore, become God's mimics like children who are dearly loved. Make love a habit, just as Christ loved you and gave himself up for us as an offering and sacrifice to God. Now notice what it says, like a fragrant perfume. Can you see Jesus did it? And how do you and I do it today? By our giving, because our giving is described in the same way that the sacrifice of Jesus on the cross is described. And so you and I this morning, as we come together, can do what is unselfish, just like Jesus. He didn't give a cautious sacrifice. He gave an extravagant sacrifice. And Jesus gave everything of himself. And we have the honor of ministering as priests and kings this morning. Before we give, I wonder if you would join with me as we say this together. Everyone together, take a deep breath. And here, and those that are watching online, we say together, one, two, three, I am a priest king with a ministry of giving. I offer up to God spiritual sacrifices that he readily accepts. Let me hear you this morning. I gladly offer up to God a steady stream of praise sacrifices. I do not neglect kindness and goodness in my ministry to God. The God-pleasing sacrifices I offer are generosity and participation. I am in the ministry of pleasing the very heart of God. I please God to no end. This is my ministry of life, abundance, and favor. I recognize and endorse my priest-king service. Every blessing of God-approved sacrifices that I make comes immediately to my family and business in Jesus' name. And everybody says, amen. Family, let's join together in prayer. What an awesome privilege it is that we can give to you as King Priests. Lord, we are those that continue in a new regime what was started in the Old Testament. And we will be faithful. We will be liberal. We will be God-honoring. We will honor you, God, as we give today in Jesus' name. And everybody says, amen. Family, there are many ways to give. You can give by card on the side. The ushers will be passing the bags by. But the Lord bless you as you give this morning.
Hi DCC family, this is a special update about Operation Hope happening on the 29th of June 2024. And we just want to say thank you so much for coming on board with us, all of our medical doctors, our volunteers, our medical specialists. You have helped us so much by giving us your time, and we are so looking forward to having you on the 29th of June 2024. What we are expecting is 2,000 people from our community of Mabel to come and have a free medical check. We want to be able to bless them with a food hamper, a hot meal on the day, and a blanket to keep them warm during winter. And we are asking, if you have not helped us yet, if you have not sent in a donation or communicated with us that you want to help us on the 29th of June 2024, I want to ask you, please, 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 why don't you extend a hand with us? Help us to bless our community and share the love of Christ in a meaningful, real way. If you would like to partner with us, please scan the QR code available for you in the foyer or contact us on 031-242-5000. We can't wait to be in contact with you.
Praise the Lord. That's going to be a great time in June as we do our Operation Hope. I'm so excited that we are going to be able to reach out and help our community in whatever way we can. And once again, if you can help us, that would be great. Can anybody and everybody say amen on that? All right. If you have your Bibles, I'd like to try and finish what I started last week. And I do have the scriptures that are available on the church app, so all the scriptures are there. But let's look at Ephesians 3 and 20 one more time in the TPT. And it says there that he will, just a little bit down, he will, God will achieve infinitely more than your greatest request, your most unbelievable dream, and exceed your wildest imagination. He will outdo them all, for his miraculous power constantly energizes you. So, Father, we want to thank you as we come to your word this morning. Thank you that, again, your word finds us and is able to deliver whatever is needed, whatever is lacking, whatever is missing. I thank you that you would cause my words to be spoken with accuracy, that I wouldn't speak, as it were, prompted by the flesh, but I would speak, as it were, given to me by the Holy Ghost, that there would be the utterance. And even as the word comes, I thank you that you said faith comes, and faith comes by hearing, and hearing. Let the spirit of faith well up in the hearts of men and women that are watching. And right now, Father, I thank you that the atmosphere in this place online is charged with your presence. And Lord, anything is impossible. As your word comes, I declare that situations will change. As your word comes, I declare that healing comes. As your word comes, I declare that there is a freedom and liberty that the people of God will experience. As your word comes, my God, whatever is needed, I thank you that your word has the power to deliver and meet every one of those needs in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen and amen. So family, I'm talking about, continuing about the power of a renewed mind. And you know, the more that I study this and look at this, the more that, you know, I feel that there's a lot of people, precious people of God, that are missing this vital, vital part when it comes to the Word and the role that the Word plays in our hearts and in our minds. So like I said before, obviously our theme is so much more, and that's described in Ephesians 3 and 20 as God wanting to achieve in every one of you infinitely more, okay? And some of us need to just take that part, and we just need to meditate on that until it becomes a reality to you in your spirit. Because of what we've been told, because of our neighborhoods, because of what the teacher spoke over us, because of what our uncles or, you know, great-grandfathers spoke over us, that we would never become much and never amount to much. Just taking that and meditating on that and saying, God, I'm just going to put myself in that place for you to achieve in and through my life infinitely more. Hallelujah. However which way you want that to manifest, whether it be infinitely more with regards to joy in my emotions, whether it be infinitely more to the expressions in my marriage, whether it be infinitely more in my business, but just to take that and meditate on that, right? And we said that the infinitely more was in three areas. It was in our greatest requests. In other words, what we are saying and asking God and praying about. And then not only that, but also in what we are dreaming and what we are imagining, both of which involve the thought part of us. All right? And I said, I gave you the Amplified version. The Amplified, let me read it one more time. It says, now to him who by, in consequence of the action of his power that is at work within us, is able to carry out his purpose and do superabundantly, far over and above all. And here it comes now, just enlarging on the two things, the saying and the thinking, all right? What we dare ask or think infinitely beyond our highest prayers, our desires, our thoughts, our hopes, or even our dreams, okay? So from what we've been looking at over these past weeks, I can tell you that without a shadow of a doubt, whatever you think about, whatever your mind is preoccupied with, will play a deciding factor on the way that your life plays out. Can I get an amen? Are we all on the same page? And then I gave you last week, and I said that actually Proverbs 23:7 says, for as a man thinks in his heart, so is he. Another translation actually says, as a man thinks in his heart, so does he become. As a woman thinks in her heart, so does she become. And so ultimately, whatever your mind is full of is what you will be end up speaking and saying. And like I said, remember Ephesians 3, it's the greatest request, unbelievable dreams, wildest imagination, all summed up in what I say and what I think. Hallelujah. And both of which play a role in God achieving infinitely more, or otherwise our theme, so much more in 2024. Would you lift your hands and say these words after me? Whatever I give my mind to will eventually be the thoughts I contain. And whatever my mind is full of will be what I say and speak with my own mouth. I don't have to believe every thought that enters my mind. Let me say that one more time together. I don't have to believe every thought that enters my mind, but only those and only those that line up with God's word and God's promises for my life. And when I speak God's thoughts and God's promises for my life, everything will begin to change for my good and my benefit, and I will reap, and I will reap, and I will reap so much more in every area of my life in 2024 and beyond, in Jesus' name. You got that, family? I said to you last week that the only thing strong enough and powerful enough and capable enough of piercing and penetrating the heart of a human being, nothing else but the Word of God. And I gave you Hebrews 4 and verse 12 in the Passion. We'll read it again. For we have the living Word of God, which is full of energy, and it pierces, more sharply than a two-edged sword. It will even penetrate. Sometimes with what we've been through and what people have spoken over our lives, you need something more than just a feel good. You need something to pierce and penetrate and break down every stronghold that the enemy has placed around your heart. Jeremiah spoke of the word like this. He said in 23:29, "Is not my word like a fire, says the Lord, and like a hammer that breaks the rock in pieces?" Amen. Lift your hands and say, God's word is the only thing available to me and strong enough to pierce and change my heart. Okay. So, continuing this morning, then when we look in the early church in the book of Acts, then that means that we ought to really, really prioritize the Word of God. And this ought to be something that we really love, really treasure, that we are diligent in studying and meditating and spending time in this book, right? I mean, if everything hinges around on what I'm thinking and what I'm saying, and only this has the power to change all of that, this should be the number one priority in our lives. And you see that when you look at the book of Acts, and more specifically, a group of people that were in a place called Berea, the Bereans. And Berea was a city in Macedonia that Paul and Silas had visited during their missionary journeys. And so if you look at Acts chapter 17, you will see that Paul and Silas come to a place called Thessalonica, and they actually spend three Sabbaths, 3 weeks, and they are in the synagogue and they are teaching the Word of God. And they are studying the Scriptures, and from the Scriptures, there are people that are beginning to believe, whose lives are beginning to be changed. As they studied the Scripture, what's happening? Their minds were being renewed, and a lot of people were coming to the knowledge of the truth. A lot of freedom, a lot of liberty, a lot of bondages were being broken as they spent 3 weeks just studying the Word of God. But the Bible says, because the devil hates for the Word of God to become flesh and blood on the inside of you. He don't mind you having the Bible on the mantelpiece you know, and having three Bibles, different translations, but all full of dust that you've never opened. He don't mind that. But just you open the Bible and you begin to study and you begin to get the Word of God on the inside of you, and he has a problem. And this is what happened in Acts chapter 17. The devil don't like it. And he found a group of people who, by the way, were Jews. And they were not persuaded, and they didn't like what they were seeing. And so in verse 5 of Acts 17, it says, "But the Jews who were not persuaded, becoming envious, took some of the evil men from the marketplace, and gathering a mob, set all the city in an uproar and attacked the house of Jason and sought to bring them out to the people." I mean, you would have thought that something terrible, catastrophic was happening there. What was Paul and Silas doing? They were simply teaching the Word of God to people. And here's a group of people that you would think, my God, I don't know, maybe there's an act of terrorism going on, maybe there's corruption going on, I don't know, maybe they're stealing and doing all kinds. All they were doing was teaching the people of God the Word of God. And it got to such a place that they had to run for their lives, and now they find themselves in a city of Macedonia called Berea. And verse 10 says, "And when then the brethren immediately sent Paul and Silas away by night to Berea." And when they arrived, what's the first thing they do? They go back into the church. That's how dearly they held onto the word. Paul and Silas knew if anything's going to change people's lives, right, it's going to be the word of God. And so they go into the synagogue. They're not put off by the Jews wanting to kill them and setting everything on fire. They go back in there and look at what it says. Verse 11 says, "While they were teaching, they were more fair-minded." There were a group of people there that were more fair-minded than those in Thessalonica, in that they received the word with all readiness. And what else did they do? They searched the scriptures daily. They searched the scriptures daily to find out whether these things were so. "Therefore, many of them believed, and also not a few of the Greeks, prominent women as well as men." Hallelujah. The Passion Translation says they found that the Jews of Berea were of more noble character and much more open-minded than those of Thessalonica. They were hungry. They were hungry for the word, family. They were hungry. Listen, if there's ever been a day and age where we've got to be hungry for the Word of God, it's now. People are more hungry, like I said last week, for Facebook than they are for God's book. There's got to be that hunger. Nobody can put that hunger in you but you. You've got to clear your schedule. You've got to make town. Sit your umtarara on it, on a chair if you need to. Open up the Bible. Get out your coloring pens. Get out your Strongs. Get out your Bible program. Get out some other reference books and begin to study the Word of God for yourself. Can I get a better amen than that? You ought to give yourself a round of applause. It says they were hungry to learn and eagerly received the word. Every day, every day. There's not a single day that you can bypass this word. When the doctor gives you antibiotics, you got to take it every day for 7 days. You miss something, and what happens? You lower the therapeutic levels for that antibiotic to have its effect, and you mess everything up. And it's like that with the Word of God. Every day, you've got to ingest the Word of God so that you can get the spiritual therapeutic levels of God's Word up in your heart, so that whatever the devil throws at you, the Word of God on the inside of you will counteract it. Hallelujah. Every day they opened the scrolls of Scripture to search and examine them to verify, okay? I need you to verify what I'm saying as well. Hallelujah. I need you to look up the scriptures and say, no, that's right, he's online. Or hang on a bit, I need to have a conversation with the pastor because I don't see the word of God lining up with the way that he speaks it, right? Another translation, the Voice translation says, now these were more noble-minded than those in Thessalonica, who were such that they received the word with all readiness of mind, daily scrutinizing. Scrutinizing is not a 5-minute job. While you're having your slice of toast and your cup of coffee, you're just having a glimpse at some scripture, or maybe you got a Bible app and then it gives you what the verse of the day is. I'm not talking, that's all great, that's all additive. We add that on, but you've got to separate yourself from all of the commotion, all of the distraction, and you've got to get alone with God, and you've got to open up His Word, and even if it's just one verse that you read, as long as that one verse has materialized, has become spiritual substance in your innermost belly, hallelujah, that you have now got a rhema or even just a little bit of a something on the inside of you, that's great. Hallelujah. So they daily scrutinize the scriptures whether these things were so. Here's what I want to say to you. We cannot expect to receive anything beyond the word level that is already operating and working in our hearts and minds. It don't matter if 10,000 people lay hands on you. We can get the best preacher, the best evangelist, the apostles of God, even the chief apostles, whoever they might be, get in everybody, fly somebody over from the United, from India, from wherever, and you can never hope to receive anything beyond the word level that is operating and working in your heart and in your minds. Okay? Praise God. So, I mean, listen, I say that because I get to pray for a lot of people. And for me, it's always a privilege to pray for people. I love to pray for people. That's what I do. But sometimes I'll ask the person, so what is the need? Okay, so they tell me the need. And then I'll say, okay, so brother, what scripture do you have? And then I just see this like blank look come on this person's face, like as if I've spoken Greek or I've spoken fluent Khoza or Sepedi. Like what scripture do you have? You know, no scripture whatsoever. Now everybody has, is there anybody here that does not have access to the word of God? That maybe for some reason, I don't know, the government has clamped down on you and somebody has forbidden you to read. Thank God those days are not here. I'm not saying we won't get there, but for the time being, everybody has access to the Word of God. Hallelujah. Some of God's people are so proud that they bought the Bible 20 years ago and it still looks like it's like new 20 years ago. Open the Bible, fold it, fold a page, underline it, scribble on it, write something down. Don't be afraid to mess up the Bible. We're not messing up the Bible. It's a way of getting these words into your heart and helping the Bible renew your mind. Hallelujah. Can you say amen? So when we pray for people and they don't have a word, like it's like, okay, so I'm going to pray, but you got to get a word on the inside of you. If you already have got a word on the inside of you, then my praying for you should just be the cherry on top. Hallelujah. In other words, the groundwork has been laid. The word has taken hold of you, and we are joining our faith together with your faith for what you are believing and what you have laid a hold of and what you have verbalized with your faith, and what you are expecting is imminent and about to happen in Jesus' name. Are you with me this morning? And so, you know, you can't speak about this without speaking about Romans 12:2. And Romans 12 and 2 basically says that we are not to be conformed to this world, but to be transformed by the renewing of our minds, that we might prove what is the good and acceptable and perfect will of God. And when I said that last week, I said to you two important things. In the Greek, it's not an option. It's not an option. All right? If we don't want to take on the mindset of the world, then we have got to renew our minds. And in God's mind, this is not an option. If we're wanting to see breakthrough, no matter, I don't care what country you're in, every country has its problems. And all over the world, the whole world is in a complete shambles. You got presidents who don't know where to walk. They go this way, go that way. Which way do I go? Here? You know? I mean, it's crazy. It's crazy what is happening in our world right now. So this is not an option. I don't want to be conformed to all the garbage that's coming from the world and come under that Babylonian system. So we've got to renew our minds. How? By laying a hold of the word. It's not an option. Bump your neighbor and say, it's not an option. If you want the victory, it's not an option. If you want to see the increase, it's not an option. If you want to see light where there's darkness, it's not an option. If you want your business to succeed, surrounded by a whole host of other businesses that have gone down, it's not an option. If you want your marriage to succeed, where everybody else is getting divorced and having an adulterous affair, it is not an option. Bump your neighbor and say, neighbor, I think he's talking to you. It's not an option. And then not only that, but in the Greek, the transformation is not something that we can put a formula to. It is a supernatural process that the Holy Ghost does. And I don't know how long that takes, and that's why you got to make time. You've got to open the Bible, sit yourself down, have your glass of water or your cup of coffee and say, right, I'm going to give myself time because this is a divine process. I can't fast track this thing. It's going to take however long it's going to take. It's going to take however long it's going to take. And as a result of the process that's taking place and I'm making space, I'm going to catch up in my life on all the other things because now my mind is renewed. I've understood what the will of God is. So now I'm ahead of time. I made time. I might have lost time. You might think you're losing time because I should be doing this and I should be doing that and I should be doing. But if you make time and allow the Holy Ghost, a divine process, a supernatural process to discern and open up your mind to understand the will of God, everything else becomes simple. You'll find you'll come back home and say, gosh, I've got 2 hours. What do I do? Go back to the Word again. Hallelujah. Can you say praise the Lord? In the Passion Translation, it says, stop imitating the ideals and opinions of the culture around you, but be inwardly transformed. Inwardly by the Holy Spirit through a total reformation of how you think. This will empower you to discern God's will. And remember, I said it wasn't just God's general will, you know, but more specifically for what you are facing, you'll discern God's will as you live a beautiful life, satisfying and perfect in His eyes. Hallelujah. Now, I took those verses, and as I was just studying, this is what the Holy Ghost gave to me. And I'm calling it the JT translation, but please don't go out of here saying I've made up my own Bible now. I'm just saying what the Holy Ghost quickened to me. And this is what He said to me. Allow God's Word to quicken your inner man by the Holy Ghost, resulting in a complete change outwardly because of the way you now think. This will enable God's dreams and imaginations to seep into your heart, so fulfilling the purpose and plans that God has for your life. That's what he told me. He said, John, you should allow me to quicken God's word in your inner man, resulting in a complete change outwardly, right? You can't change outwardly if there's been no change inwardly. So the inward change happens so that there can be an outward change, and the outward change is happening because now you're thinking differently. You are thinking the thoughts of God. Remember I said to you, you don't have to believe every thought that comes into your mind. There are going to be strange thoughts, thoughts of doubt and unbelief and fear and all kinds of stuff. That's because that's the mind. But you don't have to believe every thought that comes into your mind. Only those thoughts that line up with God's word and God's promises for your life. Now let's look at Colossians 3, all right? Because it says here in verse 1 that if then you were raised with Christ. Anybody been raised with Christ? And then it says, seek those things which are above. Seek those things which are above, where Christ is. Even though we're on this earth and our feet are planted on this earth, we're not from this. This is not our home. I do not have a citizenship of this natural earthly realm. We are citizens of the kingdom of God. Every born again child of God is a citizen of the kingdom of God. Now, verse 2 says, set your mind on things above, not on things on the earth, for you died and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. Therefore, put to death your members which are on the earth, fornication, uncleanness, passion, evil desires, covetousness, which is idolatry. That's what happens when your mind is being renewed. If you don't get on the word of God, you go back to default, and all of this stuff that we've read starts to become your thoughts, fills your heart, and that's what you play out. That's what you are speaking, and that's what you are playing out. And he says, because of these things, the wrath of God is coming upon the sons of disobedience, in which you yourselves once walked when you lived in them. But now, you yourselves are to put off all these, anger. How do we put off anger? Renew the mind. How do we put off malice? Renew the mind. How do we put off blasphemy? Renew the mind. Filthy language out of your mouth. Renew the mind. Do not lie to one another. How do we do that? Renew the mind. Since you have put off the old man with his deeds and have put on the new man, who is renewed? Who is renewed in knowledge according to the image of him who created him? It's the only way that you're going to renew your mind is through this book. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, the only way you're going to renew your mind is through the Bible. Now, set your mind. What does that mean? Set your mind is to think in a particular manner that produces the same attitude that Jesus had while on this earth. As he is, so are we. And setting your mind also means that I'm setting my mind to be wise. I'm setting my mind to be prudent. It is an opinion that comes from the word of God. It is a mindset that I'm trying to establish, a stronghold that comes from the word of God. And set your mind in the Greek is something that we have to keep on doing. In other words, it's not just a one-off thing, right? You have to be intentional and purposed about setting your mind on things that are above. So when people come to you and start talking gossip and slander, you have to politely say, listen, that's not where I'm at right now. I am in the place where I'm setting my mind on things above. And if you've got nothing good to say to me about that person, I don't want to hear. I don't want your thoughts to become my thoughts. I want God's thoughts to become my thoughts. I don't want your negativity. I don't want your naysaying. I don't want all the problems that you are seeing and all this, that, the other. I'm sorry. I'm setting my mind and I'm being purposed and intentional because I know that whatever I think and whatever I say, I will have. And I don't want what you've got. I'm sorry. I love you, but can somebody say amen? So our standard is nothing else but the Word of God. The Word of God is our plumb line and our guideline. In the TPT verse 2, Colossians 3, it says, yes, feast on all the treasures of the heavenly realm and fill your thoughts with heavenly realities and not with the distractions of the natural realm. You got it? The Message Bible says, don't shuffle along eyes to the ground, absorbed with the things right in front of you. Look up and be alert to what is going on around Christ. That's where the action is. Not what you're hearing on the news and what everybody else is saying and the politicians and the government and the marketplaces and the rand dollar and all of that. That's not where the action is. The action is in the heavenly realm. The action is I'm setting my mind on Christ and on Him alone. That's where the action is. He knows everything. He's the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the ending. Hallelujah. And if I want to see so much more in 2024, I've got to be intentional and purposed about setting my mind on things that are above. Hallelujah. And that means on a daily basis. Why? Because as soon as you miss a day of scrutinizing the scriptures, like the Berea, what happens? Your mind is offset. Distractions come. The devil wants to offset your mind. So what do you have to do? You have to reset your mind and say, no, 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 you're not going down there. No, 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 no. I'm not going to be talking about him and this and that. And you can find, it takes no faith. It takes no faith to find failures and point out all the faults in an individual, but it takes faith to look at that person, that same person, and see the potential and see the blessing and see what God is doing and pray the favor of God and the blessing of God and the increase of God on that same individual. Can I get an amen? Amen. Hallelujah. Philippians 4 and 8. Finally, brethren and sistren, whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, if there is any virtue and if there is anything praiseworthy, meditate on these things. The Passion says, so keep your thoughts continually fixed on all that is authentic and real, honorable and admirable, beautiful and respectful, pure and holy, merciful and kind. And fasten your thoughts on every glorious work of God. You ought to underline just that part there. Man, I'm going to do everything to fasten my thoughts on every glorious work of God. I'm going to go back now to January, February, March, and every high place, every breakthrough that I had, every miracle that God did, everything that God did for me, the goodness of God. I'm just going to fasten my thoughts on that, on every glorious work He did in my husband, in my wife, in my children, in my business, and I'm going to rehearse those things. I'm not going to allow distractions to come. I'm going to fix and set my mind on every glorious work that God has done and is doing in and through my life. Hallelujah. The Message Bible says, summing it all up, I'd say you'll do best by filling your minds and meditating on things that are true, noble, reputable, authentic, compelling, gracious, the best, not the worst. The beautiful, not the ugly. There's no ugly people here this morning. Bump your neighbor and say, you're not ugly. Things to praise, not things to curse. So why are we saying all of this, family? Why is it that we want to renew our minds? Why? Because let's go back to Ephesians 3:20. That's the theme. We want to renew our minds and purge our minds so that we can then begin to dream the dreams of God and allow God to paint upon the canvas of our faith the imaginations, the pictures. I often find that God speaks to me in pictures. I don't know, as a young boy, I used to love reading comics and Tintin, Asterix. Anybody remember Asterix? Young people are looking at me like, Tintin, Asterix, like, what is that all about? But I used to enjoy just seeing the pictures and the comics. A couple of words, but it was the pictures. And God is a God of pictures. Hallelujah. And there's something powerful about the imagination. Let's look at the Tower of Babel. If you don't believe in the power of imagination, let's look at the Tower of Babel. We're going to end off with this. It says, now the whole earth had one language and one speech, and it came to pass as they journeyed from the east that they found a plain in the land of Shinar, and they dwelt there. And they said to one another, come, let us make bricks. Already there, a red flag should be waving, because we're not all bricks. We're stones. And every stone is different. Every brick is the same. We're not all the same. We're not in some cult. All right? Come, let us make bricks and bake them thoroughly. And they had brick for stone and they had asphalt for mortar. And they said, come, let's build ourselves a city whose top is in the heavens. Let us make a name for ourselves. You can see these guys are totally carnal, totally anti-God, away from God, lest we be scattered abroad. But the Lord came down to see the city and the tower. And the Lord said, indeed, the people are one and they all have one language. And this is what they begin to do now. Nothing that they propose. In another translation, proposed in the Amplified, says nothing that they imagine. It says in the Amplified, the Lord said, behold, they are one people and they have all one language. And this is only the beginning of what they will do. And now nothing they have imagined they can do will be impossible for them. That's the power of imagination. These guys were wicked, evil, and anti-God, anti-Christ, anti-whatever. But God understood the power of imagination. He said, if we don't go and stop them, whatever they imagine is going to happen. If that's possible with wicked, malice, unrighteous intent, can you imagine the implications when we have our minds renewed and our imaginations are sanctified by God? What could we accomplish? What could you accomplish? Can you imagine the solutions that could come by way of dreams and imaginations? Because simply all you're doing is you're just renewing your mind. And as your mind is renewed, you're saying, God, I'm available. I'm sanctifying my mind, my thoughts. Every part of me is sanctified. And I don't have to have a dream where, you know, I see a ladder coming down. It can be a vision. It can be a picture that I have. Can you imagine? Can you imagine how different our lives would be if we could have God's dreams and imaginations imprinted in our spirits? It could make the difference between winning and losing. Can you imagine this when it comes to getting married? Right? Choosing the right person from the wrong person? Huh? Can you imagine this playing its role? You got a problem in your work, in your business, and you need a solution. And then God speaks to you in the middle of the night because you've taken time to renew your mind. And now you've got a sanctified mind. Your thoughts line up with God's thoughts, with God's word. And right there, he begins to quicken. God's dreams and imaginations begin to seep into your spirit. Hallelujah. You wake up the next morning and you know that you know. Praise God. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Oh, Father, I want to thank you for your word that's come to us. Not by my might, nor by my power, but by the power of the Holy Ghost. And I want to thank you, Lord, that you are stirring us up, God, that there would be a hunger for your word. God, your word renewing, your word quickening us. Your word revealing the will of God for us in our individual circumstances. No matter where we might find ourselves, we know that you have a plan. We know that you have the solution. We know that you have the answer. We know that as the church, we have the answer for our city. As the church and as the kingdom of God, we have the solution for our country. But I want to thank you today, Lord. Let there be a quickening. Let there be a stirring in every heart, in every person, in Jesus' name. Now, with every head bowed, every eye closed, if you were to die today and you did not know where you would land up in, because the truth is you are spirit, soul, and body, where would you spend the rest of eternity if you were to die, if you were to take your last breath today, right? So I do not have the foggiest. Well, the Bible teaches us that we can have the foggiest. We can know. We can be sure. Romans 10 tells us that if we confess the Lord Jesus Christ with our mouths and believe in our hearts that God raised him from the dead, then we shall be saved. God wants to save us from our sins because it's our sins that separate us from God. And hell was never created for any person, nobody, no human being. God created hell for the devil and his angels. But for you and me, God made a plan. He sent his only begotten son to die on a cross, to take on upon himself and become our sin. Not just to take on, but to become our sin. Yet never once was he actually sin. Never once did he yield and give in to that sin. And the judgment and fury of God was placed on Jesus Christ. So that when God now looks at humanity, he doesn't look at us through angry eyes and furious eyes. He doesn't look at us like, yeah, I'm going to teach you a lesson. Yeah, I'm going to put TB on you. Yeah, I'm going to put cancer on you just to show you who's boss. No, he doesn't do that. He placed all of his anger and fury and judgment on Jesus Christ. Why? Because a holy God demanded that sin be judged. And he placed that judgment on his only beloved begotten son, Jesus Christ. And Jesus rose on the third day. The only man that I know that died to come back to life again was Jesus Christ. And so this morning, those of you watching online, everybody here can know for sure that if they were to die, where they would spend the rest of eternity, because we are spirit, soul, and body. And though your outward man is decaying right now as I'm speaking, and though you would might one day breathe your last and we'll put you in a box, put you 6 feet underground, but the real you will keep on living. Your spirit man is eternal. And it will live eternally in the realm based on the decision that you make while you are still alive on this earth. So with every head bowed, every eye closed, those of you watching online, we're almost done. You say, Pastor, would you pray for me? Because I'm not sure right now about my salvation. I'm not sure right now about my eternal destiny. I know that I don't have peace with God for whatever reason. There's things that have happened and I'm not too proud. And you know what? Even though you might be riddled with guilt and shame and embarrassment, I want to tell you that God stands with open arms ready to receive anyone, whoever responds. He'll never force you. This is not about making you fearful, going to hell if you die. This is about the love of God. This is about God wanting His very best for you as an individual. This is God looking at you, knowing everything you said and did, but still reaching out in love and saying, come, I'm ready to forgive you. Come, I'm ready to receive you. Come, I'm ready to make you one of my own. So what I'm going to do is, just those of you that are here this morning and online, you say, Pastor, that's me. Would you pray for me? I'd be honored to pray for you. I'm going to ask those of you right now that you say, that's me. God is talking to me. With everybody else, your eyes closed. Nobody looking around. This is private. It's public, but it's private. Then right where you are, I want you just to, as I count to three, I want you just to lift your hand and say, that's me. Would you pray for me? And I'll do that. All right, you ready? Here we go. One, two, three. Lift your hand up high. Thank you. I see that hand. Anybody else? Anybody else? God bless you. Anybody else? God bless you. Anybody else? Anybody else? Wave your hand. Wave your hand. God bless you in the back. I see those hands. Several hands have been raised. We're going to dismiss you right now. I want those of you that have your hands uplifted and others as well. I'm coming down to pray for you. I want to shake you by the hand. We want to welcome you. I'm going to ask you to stand up to your feet. Take a hold of your belongings, whatever you've come with, and make your way quickly down to the front. Can you do that right now? Come quickly. Come right now in Jesus' name. Come right now, sir. Come on. Those in the back, just come. Those on the side, come on. Come, 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 come. Come in Jesus' name. Come in Jesus' name. God bless you. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. That's right. Come on. Quickly. Come on. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. That's right. Come on. Amen. 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 Come on. Come on. That's right. Come on. Come on. Let's put our hands together and give them a big God bless you this morning, family. There is room at the foot of the cross. Come on, one more time. Come home, the Father. All right, I'm going to hand back over to the presenters. Those of you that want to pray this prayer that I'm going to pray, the presenters are going to pray it with you. So let me hand you back over to the presenters. And then those of you that are here, Father, as we go our various ways, thank you that you go before us in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to ask you as you go, if you can just keep the volume down, because I want to pray for them and take time to minister.
Man, family, what an awesome time in the presence of the Lord. Romans 12 verse 2 says, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. And I'm so glad that there are so many of you right now that have said, Cody, and responded to Pastor John's call to say that I want to give my heart to the Lord. And I want to encourage you right now that if you say while watching online that you want to give your heart to the Lord, I wonder if you would with me repeat this prayer together as we give our hearts to the Lord and dedicate and just give our hearts to the Lord and start this new walk of salvation together. Let's say this prayer together. Dear Heavenly Father, I come to you today. I give my heart to you. I believe that you are the Son of God. You defeated death, hell, and the grave. Today I give my heart to you. I thank you that my sins are washed. I thank you that I'm made new. I thank you that my past is over. And there's newness of life in you. I thank you, Lord God, for my new life in you. And I serve you with my whole heart. Nothing, nothing, nothing is going to be too difficult for me. As I renew my life afresh, anew, for you. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Family, if you say, Cody, I've made a decision to follow Christ, if you say that I've said that prayer, I want to encourage you to get onto our website. There's a tab that says, I've made a decision. I want to encourage you, click on that tab and fill in that form. Our pastors are waiting to receive those forms and pray for you, give you a call, and walk this new life of salvation with you. Man, I was so encouraged by this word, Romans 12, when it speaks about being transformed by the renewing of the mind. I was just thinking of that movie. I don't know if you've watched that movie, Transformers, and how they are these machines, these mobile machines that are conformed to the roads of this world. And how many of us have been conformed to the world system, the journey of life? But the Word of God says that we need to be transformed. And if those vehicles didn't transform into those superheroes, how were they going to be able to defeat death, hell, and the grave? And I want to encourage you to do the same thing. Transform by the renewing of your mind, and know that nothing is impossible when you put your trust in the Lord. So until we see you again next week, family, I'm so excited, and know that this week is going to be the best week that you've ever had and ever experienced. I want to encourage you, testify of the goodness of God. Renew your mind in the Word of God, and know that nothing is impossible with God. So until we see you again next week, family, goodbye, and God bless you.